Alrighty, guys. I have sped paint, a unit of fodder for Turnip 28. They come in a group of 12, which I think is the perfect number when it comes to batch painting. Any more and the whole process becomes a little too slow and tedious and demotivating. And this time I have done all of my preparation ahead of time. I've written down all the steps I'm going to take and have all the paints I'm going to use lined up in the order I'm going to apply them.
Yeah, this is a, how you say, a mise en place? Je m'appelle, s'il vous plaît.
Unfortunately, I have prepped my models about a year ago and did not have the foresight to record that process. But I hit them from underneath with a cream rattle can, then laid down a zenithal of pure white from above and with another rattle can, and then slopped on a thin brown homemade wash and lightened some areas back up with a quick white dry brush. So that is my current formula for my take on the slap chop method. And now we can begin. Step one, I'm going to pop some Beowulf Blue Speed Paint 2.0 on the coats, which is mainly just the sleeves here. I am using a silicone fidget toy designed for neuro irregulars because when the speed paint eventually dries in here, you can just pop out the whole crust and it's basically clean and ready to go immediately. And I do love me my speed paints, but there are certainly some cons that cannot be ignored. One, you have to be precise and perfect, especially with these minis in particular, where much of the model will remain white. And ideally, I want to keep these guys as clean as possible for as long as possible, so that when I weather them up, the brown dirtiness contrasts with the clean whiteness of their clothes, to really just show off how dirty they've gotten. Problem the second. When the speed paints start to dry, they really goop up and gunk up on the mini and in the brush and in the pot, and there's a limit to how much you can fix this by just adding water. This problem was exacerbated by the fact that it was nearly 90 degrees in the old painting room, and the goopifying, gunkifying process occurs much more quickly under those circumstances. And once your pool of speed paints is getting chunks in it, it's pretty much unusable, and you just have to pour a new pool of speed paint. It can also mess up your brushes pretty bad, so I would not use your nice weasel hair brushes with this stuff. I am using Princeton synthetic brushes, which are much more expensive than regular synthetic brushes. These are about like a buck or two each, but they keep their point quite well compared to the cheapo synthetic brushes. And I could list off even more problems with speed paints, but even with all of those issues combined, the speed and efficiency they offer just so vastly outweighs all of the problems they have, at least for my purposes, that I still find them worth it to use. Now, another difficulty with this step is the fact there are so many straps and folds that I have to decide whether or not they should be part of the vest and what should be a part of the coat. I tried checking some reference images, but at this point I had realized that these are Austrian infantry, which are effectively entirely white, and that I had decided to paint them in the colors of French infantry. So I was basically just going to have to make up my own color placement for a lot of these parts on these guys. And this was far and away the longest step in the process, which was made even longer by the fact that I had to do a bunch of cleaning up and repainting of the white on the first couple of minis, where I had changed my mind about the placement of where I decided the white should end on the vests. So for painting on the white, I used So Flat Titanium White, which is pretty much exactly what I want from acrylic paints. It is super thick and super pigmented, so I have 100% control as to how thin I want this paint to get. And it's quite affordable, coming in at approximately the same price as the current Army Painter line. And a quick plea from me to the paint companies. If you make acrylic paints, please put them in dropper bottles. And paint companies, but mostly Army Painter, if you make speed paints, please put them in pots. Thank you. And I know, oh, but what about the people who want to use their speed paints with their airbrush? And to that I say,
logic clearly dictates that the needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few.
Now, at this point, I was going to apply a coat of holy white on all of the white sections, but I had then decided it's already both white and shaded. I'm not going to waste my time with this. So next, I am applying Forest Sprite to the tufts on their back. At this point, I am not concerned about being clean, because the brown I will apply later on their haversacks and their helmets should mostly cover up any green that I get on them. And if some of it does show through, we'll just call it a moldy, mossy spot. Oh no. Disaster has struck. Call me Quasimodo from that one scene during the festival, because I have been crowned the King of Fools. I let my phone die and I lost 40 minutes of footage. Whoopsie daisy, lesson learned. Make sure you charge your phone before recording. In that lost footage, I painted the cuffs with bright red alongside the musket slings. It was a bit tough on some of these sculpts to tell where the musket ends and the straps begin, so I just had to freeball some of these. Then the hands were painted with Crusader skin. And here is a composite sketch as to what the scene looked like while I was painting this. And you're just gonna have to believe that it was actually me and not a rumpled Stiltskin who teleported in and painted these pieces for me in exchange for my firstborn child. And I'm back. I am finishing applying hardened leather brown to the helmets, their entire kit, and the entire gun and their shoes. Now I am thinning down a bit of fresh rust and applying it to their helmet and the metal bits of the musket. Now I'm breaking out the old wet palette and squirting out some plate mail metal. And I know you're not supposed to use metallics on a wet palette for a variety of reasons, but you can't control me.
I'm a dog chasing cars.
Okay, so now I am dry brushing the silver all over the rusty parts. Now I am coming in with a silver Sharpie to get a highlight on those metal parts. I like to use a bit of a stippling motion here, but I'm just trying to clip the outermost edges of the top of the helmet, the nose, and a line running from the tip of the bayonet to the bottom of the gun barrel. Next, I am hitting all of those buttons with a gold Sharpie. For these, I like to use more of a swirling, circular motion. And in general, I am a big fan of using these Sharpies to highlight metallics. You don't have to load up your brush or clean it or anything like that. It is just quick and clean, and it has led me to try a bunch of other colored Sharpies to highlight a bunch of different other colored miniatures. But the results were pretty disappointing. They come out a little glossy and translucent, which is great for metals, but extremely situational for everything else. Now I'm mixing up a brown wash with a bunch of random washes I have, some flow improver and medium until I get a consistency that I like. And I added some ink here because I wanted it to be a bit more vibrant of a brown, but this made the finish quite glossy, so I would avoid adding ink to this mix in the future. Anyway, I am now slathering this grimy concoction over every square millimeter of every single mini. Which I gotta say, this has gotta be my favorite part of mini painting. I love seeing all the details pop out in a single step, which normally this is generally considered bad form and the noob approach to miniature painting. And this is all the more reason why I love Turnip 28 so much. The fact that everyone is supposed to be filthy and desaturated makes this wash step a substantiated artistic choice rather than just a lazy shortcut. And this approach is the one that I find to be the most fun when it comes to miniature painting. Now we are finally nearing the home stretch. I've added some gray to my wash concoction to make a very desaturated brown that I'm going to cover the bases with. I like using very non-vibrant colors for the base to make the now muddied colors of the mini just pop a little bit more. Next, I'm gonna add a bit of orange to my muck mixture and use a couple of coats of that to paint the base rims. Now I want to add some more dirt to these guys, so I'm going to smack on some brown chalk pigments from their elbows down, making sure to cover the base as well. Then I'm going to spray some isopropyl all over them to seal in this powder, which darkens it and softens it a bit. So if you want that dusty finish for a desert environment, this would be bad and not desirable. But since I'm going for general grunginess, I am happy with the changes that come from sealing it in. Unfortunately, disaster number two has occurred. I was too impatient with letting the base rims dry, and I think the addition of the alcohol prevented the paint from setting correctly, and it started wiping off on my fingers. So I had to scrape off the base rims and repaint them. This time I added a little primer into the mix to hopefully increase the adhesion. As my dad would say, you either do it right or you do it twice. We are now on to the last step. I am taking some gloss varnish, mixing in a touch of my muck, and two drops of blue-green alcohol ink. And with that, I'm going to sporadically cover about 50% of each base to make some wet mud spots. Turnip 28 is the squelchy war game, after all. And with that,
it's done.
I am pretty happy with the outcome. They look like they were once prim and proper Napoleonic infantry, that have since spent one too many days trudging through the mud. All in all, excluding drying times and the base rim snafu, this took me just under 3.5 hours, which divides down to about 17 minutes a mini, which is a pace that if I can keep it up, then I can finish my entire turnip army in probably just a couple of weeks. In the future, I would make the shoes, the sabers, and the cartridge box black. One, to sort of just break up the kit a little bit more, and two, because the brown shoes just make it kind of easy for the whole silhouette of the model to get lost in the mud, and I feel like shiny black shoes will maybe make the model a little more readable. But that's gonna do it for this video. Thank you for watching, and goodbye! Oh,